Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 43rd President of the United States, George W. Bush.
Thank you all. Please be seated. Thank you. Thank you. Romo. Mother would have liked you a lot. Thank you all for coming. Laura and I welcome you. This is an unusual event honoring Barbara Bush. And we thank you for being here. I want to thank Highland Capital for sponsoring this Engage event. I want to thank our team led by Ken Hirsch and Holly Kuzmich for your leadership. I welcome the Turners, who he happens to run SMU, by the way, and we're incredibly proud of our relationship with SMU. I want to thank our board members who are here, and I want to thank the grandkids who took time to come. So the second panel will be Barbara, Jenna, Ellie, Pierce, and Jebby. And there's no telling what's going to happen with the second panel. So my notes say, give reflections on Barbara Bush as a mother. Man, she was a piece of work. She was funny. She could be blunt. She was kind of a blurter. I don't know if that's a noun, but she was a very compassionate person and always loving. So ever since I quit drinking, I didn't hear voices, but I heard one last night. It was Mother saying, George, why are you going to spend 2 hours talking about me at your library? I didn't answer back. I was somewhat taken aback. And then she said, are you going to wear those ugly looking shoes? At any rate, we all miss her, but she's going to come to life tonight for you. Our first panel is going to be moderated by Cokie Roberts, well-known figure in the media, good friend, and a fine person. Susan Baker will be here. She has been Mother's longtime friend. She gave a eulogy at Mother's funeral, which was a darn good one. Susan Page, she writes for the USA Today. She's the Washington Bureau Chief of USA Today. But more importantly, she has got a book coming out in April called The Matriarch. It's about Mother. And finally, my chief of staff, my first 5 years, a dear friend, someone who worked in my dad's White House, who has been exposed to Mother a lot, and has handled her in her good moments and her sometimes not so good moments. And that would be Andy Card. Please welcome our panel.
Well, good evening. I must say, when I woke up in Washington this morning and realized it was going to be yet another bad hair day, I thought, oh Lord, Mrs. Bush always told me to do something about my hair. Pretty much every time she saw me, unless I was gussied up for TV. So here I am. I'm sorry, Mrs. Bush. But we have such an interesting combination of folks here who have known Mrs. Bush in many ways of her life, and Susan Page, who's now written a book about her, so she probably knows more than we think she does. But I want to start with her dear friend, Susan Baker, because Susan, you said at the funeral that Barbara Bush was the gold standard of what it meant to be her friend. And you've talked about how she, when you got to Washington, she started inviting you regularly to Sunday lunch and all of that. But she was not just warm and welcoming, she pushed you too. She said, you've said she pushed you out the door.
She really did. And I kind of resisted because I'd rather, much rather be in the audience than out front. But she really kind of gave me the courage. She just said, come on, you've got some important causes and you've got to take advantage of your husband's position. And I'm so thankful that she did it.
And including hosting events at the vice president's house.
Well, that was the best because this was a cause that didn't have a lot of supporters at the time in the early 80s. And making people aware of homeless situation was really important. And if we'd had a meeting that wasn't at the vice president's house, they probably wouldn't have come. And also, she would invite very prominent homeless leaders who'd made some big headlines, and it wasn't very
popular.
The administration was not real keen about that. But Barbara did it. She just had courage. But I'll tell you, the way she cared, it wasn't just me. She did the same kind of thing for so many of her friends. She was a remarkable friend in every way.
And Andy, you've said she was a fierce protector of her friends, and especially of her family, and that she had an uncanny ability to read people, both for good and for bad. So tell us the Sununu story.
She was Barb. First of all, she was the definition of love. Mm-hmm. She loved her husband unbelievably. She loved her family. She would give love, and she wasn't afraid to give tough love. And I witnessed a lot of the tough love. Sometime I was expected to pass on the tough love, which was very difficult. But I remember first seeing her when she was really talking about trips to China in a slideshow, and she was a little bit shy. And I remember her empowering her daughter, Doro, to step up and learn the slideshow and give the slideshow. I remember her doing cross-stitching at every down moment, writing notes. I remember her thinking of detail. I remember her being passionate about things that were happening in her peripheral vision that we didn't see. But most of all, I do remember her appropriate, biting commentary. There was one that, this is reported by Tim Russert. John Sununu, who had been chief of staff to President George H.W. Bush, and I was deputy chief of staff, John Sununu was probably the most intelligent person I've ever met. He was not that smart.
Not easy to deal with.
An IQ of 180. And he didn't suffer fools kindly, and I was the closest fool to him. But his tenure as chief of staff had ended, and Tim Russert reports that about a month after John Sununu left as chief of staff, Barr was in a place where Governor Sununu came in, and he kind of pounded his chest. Why is it that people take such an instant dislike to me? And I'll never forget what Tim Russert said. She said, it's much more efficient that way.
Saves time.
So she was very good at passing on, even to her son, the president, commentary, taste your words before you spit them out, or that language isn't appropriate here. He had very good language as president. He didn't have such good language before he became president. And that's the witness that I saw, but she also made sure that everyone in the orbit of her husband helped him do his job. And she cared deeply about his successes, but she wanted to make sure that they weren't successes for him because he couldn't practice braggadocio, that they were successes for everybody else. So, her conscience was much bigger than you realize, mm-hmm. both good and bad, but it was always for a greater good. And she would cause us to see things differently, And it's very easy in the White House to believe you know everything. And Barbara Bush made sure that you didn't think you knew everything. So she was a joy to work with, but she was also a challenge to listen to. And I greatly appreciated the wisdom that she had. She was a true wisdom woman. Mm-hmm. She was contagious in her love, but she did also teach us to practice tough love when it was necessary.
Susan, as you started writing this book, you eventually was given access to pretty much all of Barbara Bush's life, including her diaries, which is a remarkable thing to give a writer. Why do you think she did that?
You know, it was so interesting. I wanted to do this book. I wanted to do it because with all the people I've covered in Washington, I thought Barbara Bush was the one person Americans thought they knew best, but in fact understood least. And I thought she was...
And why is that? What
I think people thought she was friendly, wonderful, white-haired, cookie-baking grandmother. It is true that she was a grandmother, but in fact, as I've learned, she did not bake any cookies. And it just, it so underestimated her influence and the role that she played. So I wasn't sure there would be interest in the publishing world. We had six publishers bid on this book, which was a sign of the continuing curiosity people have about Barbara Bush. And only at that point did I write her and tell her I was going to do the book, because I was worried two things would happen if I told her beforehand. I was worried she would say, no, I won't cooperate, in which case I felt I was going to be screwed, like, I'm going to write a book if she wouldn't cooperate. But I worried if I asked her beforehand and she said yes, she would think she had some control over the book. And so I signed the contract and then sent her this letter. And after about 2 weeks, she sent me a letter saying she would meet with me once, which she did. And then at the first interview, she said she'd meet with a second time. And in the end, I had five long interviews with her in the last 6 months of her life. And at the first interview, she said, and you will never see my diaries. And I said, well, I understand that diaries are very personal. And then in the third interview, I said, you know, I know I can't see your diaries, but I wonder if I could just see some excerpts that deal with Reza Gorbachev, because I was very interested in their relationship. And she said, I'll think about it, which I thought meant no, but I'm not going to say that to your face. And in the fifth interview I had, which turned out to be the last interview, although I didn't know it was that last interview, I don't know if she knew it was going to be our last interview because her health was failing. At the end of that, without me asking, she said, and I've decided you can see all my diaries.
Wow.
And I went, really? I can. Are you sure? And I think that she was at the state, she knew that she was at the end of her life. I think that she knew she had lived a big life with a lot to say and a big impact. And I think she was ready to let people see that. It was a great privilege and honor to be able to see that. And I'm grateful to her.
Had you known her before? Had you?
So, I've covered 10 presidential campaigns. The first one was in 1980, and the first national politician I ever interviewed was George H.W. Bush. And my biggest interchange with her in the years that I covered the Bush administration was in 1990, I was on duty for Newsday up at Kennebunkport, and the Bushes always gave this party, this picnic for the press that was on duty up there. And I went to it with my two young sons. And I had no personal interchange with Mrs. Bush before that. She came up to me and she gave me the world's hardest time for working when my kids were young. And how dare you work when you have little children? And I am taken aback. At first I thought she was kidding, so I made some crack and it was clear she was not kidding. And at that point, I tried to like actually physically back away from her. This was a few months after the Wellesley speech. And in fact, she felt I shouldn't be working if I had two little kids. Also, my kids were not that well behaved. She might have thought, if I were not working, my children would
be better behaved. But not possible. Yeah. But. Well, you know, the first time actually that I interviewed her in a sit-down interview was at the vice president's house, and it was for 17 magazine, and I was interviewing her and Kitty Dukakis, And it had all been arranged and all of that. And I arrive, and the vice president's house is a little intimidating. And I come in, I sit down, or I'm waiting for her, and she comes in and she says, "What are we doing here?" And I said, "I'm here to interview you." And she said, "For 17 magazine?" And I said, "Yes." And she said, "They can't vote." I finally convinced her it was okay. But some of them were older and they had parents and such. Anyway, there was she didn't hold anything back. I think that's fair to say.
That's right.
Right. Moving here, and Susan, at what point did you meet Barbara Bush?
Well, in early 60s, 61 or 62, when they had been in Houston a few years. And what I was really taken with about her was, from the beginning, she was so interested in everybody she met. She was such a relational person. And she invited me to lunch with somebody else after we'd been there a while. And then the way she nurtured all the volunteers that were in all the campaigns, she made us feel like we were the most important people in the world. And she would needlepoint all the time these little signs that say Bush, and she'd put them on little baskets and give them to people to thank them for doing. And she also made canvas bags. She was one of the most energetic, involved people I've ever seen in the world. I mean, it was her energy level was remarkable. And I just think, you know, she had this motto that you're going to be judged about the success of your life by your relationships with your family, your friends, your coworkers, and people you meet along the way. And so for her, everybody had value. Now, she was even nice to people she really didn't like. I mean, she could come out with a marvelous quip and everything, but she tolerated people. And I remember once, there were some people that had been so pushy, and I was just, I won't say what. But Barbara treated them with kindness. And I thought, you know, she's teaching me the way you've got to be with people. It was beautiful.
And she's talked about in her books and other places the move to Texas from Connecticut, getting away from the gaze of the parental gaze, I think is how she put it. And did you see that? Did any of you see that as liberating for her?
As a what?
Liberating.
I think she was liberated, period. But I think this, that she was so engaged in whatever that her man was doing, and she wanted to do it with him, and she was just a fabulous life partner. And so much fun. I mean, she really was so much smarter than people understood, but she had this self-deprecating humor, which made, you know, people not realize how really, really brilliant she was. And when you think about all the things she managed, all the campaigns, all the travel, all the summers at Kennebunkport, where she not only had wonderful family, but she had an endless stream of visitors, some of whom were potentates or heads of state. And here she was, she didn't have a massive staff. She had to be planning and doing everything. And the flow and ebb of dinners, people not coming, golf, tennis. I mean, she was in the middle of it and she never tired. I mean, I'm sure she did, but she kept on.
Andy, that business of how smart she was. I mean, you said she had sort of peripheral vision. And you've also said that even though she didn't sort of put her thumb on the scales in terms of policy, she always asked about consequences.
I don't ever remember Mrs. Bush saying the policy should be. I do acknowledge that there were many times that she would say, "Have you thought about this? Or did you know that?" and it would raise your conscience. And she invited peripheral vision. I'm going to say it again. She invited us to pay attention to that which we didn't see at the White House. Look outside and see what's happening. It was very valuable. She couldn't cook, though. President George W. Bush told me that she was a lousy cook. I had the benefit of enjoying her cooking a few times, and yeah, she was not a good cook.
Why did she even try?
But I would say, no, I have to say something. There was something in Laura Bush's book that struck me about Barr. And it was when Laura invited the Bushes to come meet their children, their grandchildren, Barr's grandchildren. And they ran out of the house and said, "Ganny, Ganny." And in Laura's book, she said that Barr was so appreciative that she had taught them about her before they came out. And she loved her family. Her family was the top. And you were not allowed to say anything negative about the family. She would say And sometimes you were there when she was saying it and you felt uncomfortable. Right, Jenna and Barbara? But she was just very giving. I do have to tell you one story.
Please.
You should know that you do not apply to become the president's chief of staff. The president doesn't go to ZipRecruiter or LinkedIn to find a chief of staff. And when President Bush was hinting that I should be his chief of staff, I thought he was hinting that I should be the director of his transition. So I thought that he was sending me to meet with Clay Johnson about transition. He asked me to meet with Clay Johnson, then he asked me to call him on the road. I called him on the road, and then he asked me to come see him in Florida just before the election. But before I went to Florida, I was supposed to go see his parents in Houston. And I thought that was a strange suggestion that I should do. I went to Houston. His parents were not in the house. The Secret Service was there. I felt like it was a museum. I had to sit there all day, bored, convincing there were cameras watching me. They finally came home after a long day of campaigning for their son. Barr came in first, then the president came in, and we had peanut butter and banana or carrot sandwiches. And went to bed. The next morning I got up and I slept in the guest room. I made the bed, I took a shower, I was all dressed. And Barr comes to the door and says, "You're already up and you're dressed." "Yes, I am, I get up very early." And then she said, "Did you even sleep in the bed?" And I said, "Oh, I slept in the bed." And she said, "Have you had any coffee yet?" And I said, "No." She said, "Well, go grab a cup of coffee, you know where it is, and come join us." I went and got a cup of coffee. They were in bed. I stood outside the bedroom. I'm standing on the threshold with my cup of coffee. The TV is on. Both the president and the former first lady are commenting on the news on TV. And then they're interspersing it like, come on in, lie down with us. And so I go in, lie down in the bed. The president says, "Lie there, right there." So the president, Barr, me, laying in bed with a cup of coffee.
Were any dogs involved?
And the conversation is strange because it's commenting on the news, it's commenting on the campaign, and then it's, "You know what it's like. You'll take care of him. You'll help him. You know what it's like." And I have to admit, I said, "Are they talking about the transition?" But that was so telling, because I was an intermediary sometimes between the former president and the former first lady. The president would be frustrated with it, and I remember one time I went down there to say something to him, and he said, "Did my mother call you?" And she hadn't on that moment, but she did other times. But I was struck by how much she cared about him and Laura and the burden that they had to carry. So it was a great privilege to be included in that relationship.
I want to talk a good bit here about her time as First Lady, but before I get to that, Susan, when you were talking to her and reading the diaries, the time in China was terribly important.
You know, she. If you ask Barbara Bush what her favorite period of time was, she often would say China was the best of times because it was the one time where she was there and there weren't parents around and there weren't children around. It was just the two of them. And, you know, that was it was basically the longest, it was about a year, a period of time that they had just each other without others around. And I think more than being in China, which was then, of course, an incredibly exotic place, place Americans thought they would never go, I think it was as much the opportunity to be with George H.W. Bush, just the two of them, as it was the exotic locale they were in.
In her time as First Lady, there's the iconic picture of her going to Grandma's house and hugging that baby at a time when HIV/AIDS was considered, you know, untouchable. And I noticed that in the earlier video we saw that Bono was here, and he's referred to her as the godmother of PEPFAR. We're going to hear from the mother of PEPFAR in a little bit. But I'm wondering, you all have talked about how she was sort of naturally empathetic when she saw that baby, and that in some ways you think it related to her experience with losing her daughter, Robin.
I do. I think that the death of Robin when Barbara Bush was just 28 years old was a thread through the whole rest of her life. Mm-hmm. I think it affected her kindness and compassion and empathy for people. I think it also made her less patient with blather. I think that that's one reason she thought if you're going to be idiotic about something, she would tell you about it. I think it was a searing experience, those 6 months, that just shaped her in fundamental ways. And I think the experience, when Robin was sick and being treated at Sloan Kettering, they brought her back to Midland for one last visit. And she found that even some of her closest friends refused to come over and see her because she had leukemia. It was a very mysterious disease at the time. A lot of people hadn't heard of it, or they thought maybe it would be catching. And that was wounding to her. And I think she saw something similar happening with people who had HIV/AIDS. You know, it's easy to forget at this point how what the stigma was like then,
right.
How President Reagan had ignored AIDS in the first, even after it was described and we realized what a health crisis it was early in his term. And I think that she was determined to show empathy and kindness toward people who had HIV/AIDS. She visited AIDS babies through the campaign in 1988. That wasn't new for her. And actually, I was interested in why she went to Grandma's house, and it was one of the things I found in doing research for this Bush book. What actually happened was, in the transition to his presidency, the Public Affairs Transition Office decided, in the spirit of 1,000 points of light, that they would, instead of buying each other Christmas presents, they would collect money and give it to a charity. And they collected about $700, and they decided to give it to Grandma's house. And one of the people working in the transition office actually delivered it personally to Grandma's house. And this was a time when they wouldn't have a sign out front because neighbors were afraid of being the target of attacks. Neighbors would protest if they knew it was treating kids who had HIV/AIDS. And the Grandma's house then sent a letter to the transition saying, thanks so much for the money, and we would love to have Barbara Bush visit us. And that letter got sent to her office, and she visited Grandma's house during the first 100 days of the presidency in March. And that was extraordinary. That was headlines around the world. And it was because she not only visited, but she held the baby without any fear, right? So she doesn't have protective clothing on. People were afraid to touch people with AIDS at that point. And she also made a point. She had a private meeting with adults who had HIV/AIDS. The press wasn't in that. And one of the men in the meeting said to her, you hug the baby, but people think the babies are innocent victims of AIDS. Mm. People don't feel that way about us. Grown-ups. We need a hug. And so she, in the private meeting, she gave him a hug, and then they went out to see the press that was there, including some photographers, and she made a big point of going over and hugging the man in front of the cameras so there would be pictures of her hugging an adult with AIDS to make the point that he had made with her.
Can I jump in?
There was yes,
a,
please do.
There's a parallel to that story. Some people working at the White House were very uncomfortable that she had embraced the AIDS community. And this was controversial politically. And she did call over to the White House and spoke to me and said, I don't think this person is serving my husband well. And we had to make a change at the White House.
The person, because so, he was saying,
she was fearless.
She was fearless.
She really was fearless.
And it was a tough thing to hear, but it was exactly right. Mm-hmm. And she was, again, a conscience.
And there was actually a political rebound problem it created. You remember that President Bush then got challenged by Patrick Buchanan for the Republican nomination. And a lot of that was cultural conservatism.
Right.
And the whole issue, not so much of AIDS, but of gay rights, became something that was a political issue. And you know who did not back down on that? That would be Barbara Bush.
Well, probably. Another thing,
the person that should be, or the, not the, the creatures that should be in this discussion are really C. Fred and Millie, because they probably know much more than
that's we true. Know. The another place where controversy came up was when she was asked to give the commencement speech at my alma mater, Wellesley College, and I must say at the time I was horribly embarrassed that the young women who were there were raising a ruckus because she wasn't a career woman. But she went to Wellesley and she absolutely hit a home run.
Whatever the times, one thing will never change. Fathers and mothers, if you have children, they must come first. You must read to your children, and you must hug your children, and you must love your children. Your success as a family, our success as a society, depends not on what happens in the White House, but on what happens inside your house.
That's why you got in trouble, Susan.
It was a month later that she came up to me and said, your children have to come first.
But of course, the other really smart thing she did, in addition to her wonderful speech, was bring with her Raisa Gorbachev. And Susan, you were there, Susan Baker, you were there at the White House when the two of them had a private visit. Millie was also there on Mrs. Gorbachev's foot, apparently. And you saw that they really formed a bond.
Well, yes, and it was very interesting because Raisa was not easy. And Barr made every effort to, you know, have things be smooth, and she'd say something fun and get some kind of funny reaction from her. But she said, you know, she's having to act a certain way to please the people at home, and the way she dressed and things like that. And so as Barr was trying to be a great hostess, she really took into account exactly what Raisa was going through, and she did just the right thing. And to have her at Wellesley was just a 10 strike.
Right.
Everybody. And I remember thinking how marvelous that these young women who think that they know what to do and what's right, to have her come along and say, both ways are right. It's important to be a mother, to do that. It's also important to have a career. But in your career, don't forget about relationships. Don't forget to have fun. Life is to be enjoyed. And so I just think it was a marvelous thing, and it was needed desperately at that particular time.
Did the Gorbachev thing cause stirs?
Well, yes. You probably remember at the time there was even tension in our global partners as to how we were going to treat with Gorbachev and what was going on. Was this a real thing or not? So the invitation for President Gorbachev to come to the United States was a big deal. And for Barbara Bush, the First Lady, to take Riesa with her to Wellesley was a 10 strike. I mean, it was a bonus. It wasn't something that was contrived. It wasn't a plan. It was Barbara Bush wanted to do it. And so this was not part of the political community or the diplomatic community. And she actually kind of wanted to know if it would be all right if she invited her. So she was acquiescing and willing to acquiesce, but she wanted to do it. I think that speech was one of the greatest speeches ever given by a First Lady. And I do tell my grandchildren that they have to listen to that speech and read it. But Barbara Bush at that time helped calm the waters so that people didn't think we were going too far with Gorbachev, or not far enough. It was the right thing to do at the right time. And she helped give a more personal side to it, so it wasn't just global politics or diplomacy. It was much more intimate. And Barbara Bush allowed that intimate relationship to be there.
But Susan, you came to understand that it wasn't spontaneous. She had planned this.
So Barbara Bush, as Second Lady, had watched Nancy Reagan and Reza Gorbachev just go to war with each other. I mean, there was like a civil war between them. And
it wasn't civil.
Yes, it was not. it was pretty fierce. And you know, it wasn't exactly a problem, but it was sort of a problem. You know how if you have a really good friend, but your husband hates, you know, if the spouses don't get along, then you can never have dinner together, and I think Barbara Bush felt it was not helpful to the United States for Nancy Reagan to have a feud with Reza Gorbachev, although, as you say, Reza Gorbachev could be pretty difficult. And so Barbara Bush wrote a letter to her brother, Scott, just before the first time she was going to see Reza Gorbachev as First Lady. And she wrote to Scott, and she's going to be my friend no matter what she does. And that was what she did. No matter what Reza Gorbachev did, she made it work. I remember when I was covering them at one of the summits, Reza Gorbachev and Barbara Bush came out holding hands. Now, women in Russia hold hands. Women in Texas do not generally walk around holding hands. And I saw that and I thought, you know, Barbara Bush will do whatever it takes to build a relationship with Reza Gorbachev. And it was not just a matter of being cordial. This was important in the geopolitics of the day. Brian Mulroney, who was a Canadian prime minister at the time, told me that the fact that Barbara built this relationship of trust with Reza was helpful because Reza was a very important advisor to her husband. So at a point where trying to build trust between the two superpowers to negotiate the end of the Cold War, this relationship was a valuable thing to have, and it reflected a conscious determination on Barbara Bush's part that she was going to make it happen. And I think by the end of time, by the end of their relationships when Reza Gorbachev died, they in fact had a friendly relationship. But they would have had a friendly relationship no matter what, as she said, no matter what Reza Gorbachev does, we're going to be friends.
It's quite remarkable. After she left the White House, of course, literacy became, well, it was all along, but in that speech, read to your children, always read books, all of that. What do you think, Susan Baker, was the sort of impetus for that advocacy?
Well, she just saw how, well, first of all, she was a voracious reader. Mm-hmm. She loved to read. And she just knew that families, particularly that can't read, can't progress. And so she just came to the idea that literacy was something that was necessary, and so she loved it, and she just made it her cause. And I think that she had other causes as well, but she was, when they came back to Houston, they did, you know, they've had so many of those literacy programs, but she did other things. And I think they were in their 80s, early 80s, and they'd been in the newspaper and on the TV every day that week because they were, you know, helping good causes. And I called her and I said, Barr, what are you all doing? How can you keep this up? And she just said, well, we're just doing what we want to do. And I said, well, I think you're nuts. And she laughed and she said, I think you're right. But they kept on doing it.
Well, and she went all over the country, her literacy programs now in 12 states, I think, and 100 and some programs, and she was very hands-on with it.
Oh, totally. And she inspired people to really support. She was very good at that. You know, she
that's a way of saying putting the arm on you.
That's right.
The other place where she was just seemingly indefatigable was campaigning and Susan, you've added up with 7 presidential campaigns, and that doesn't count the congressional campaigns, the senatorial campaigns, the gubernatorial campaigns, all of those, and including when she was 90 years old in the snows of New Hampshire for her son Jeb.
That's a remarkable picture from the 2016 campaign. Are they showing it? Yes. So there she is. She's 90 years old. She's in a snowstorm in New Hampshire. Don't think that umbrella is doing anything for her. That is having really no effect. She's not even wearing a hat, and she's pushing her walker. Now, I heard one person speculate that she didn't actually need to use her walker there, and it was to make a point to everyone, but that I don't know.
Please, I'm glad she did on the ice.
But, you know, she did it for 2 reasons, I think. She did it because she would do anything for her family, so she would do anything for her son, Jeb. And I think she also didn't much like that Donald Trump was doing so well in the primary at that point, and she wouldn't want to go campaign for the other guy.
But you all saw her doing those campaigns over and over again.
Just amazing. Her energy level is just astounding. It really was. And I was thinking, you know, even till the very end, and she was as sharp as she could be. I was reading to her the week that she passed away, and the nurse came in to do something with oxygen, and we stopped, and then it was time to resume again, and I'd lost my place. And she said, Susan, the last sentence said this.
Well, that's a good thing that you didn't see her become a different person. And she was, to me, that's really what I will always remember is her just total authenticity. Mm-hmm. We have so many people who have been media trained within an inch of their lives and are so smooth, or at least they think they are. And she was who she was.
I love the quote, and I wish I knew who'd said it. Barbara Bush is as authentic as her pearls are fake.
When I was looking at her diaries, and I thought, you don't know what you're going to find when you look at diaries, whether you're going to find the dark underside of Barbara Bush or the alter ego of Barbara Bush. And the striking thing to me was that the diaries, which including the very private diaries before she was in political life, the diaries are exactly what she presented in public. They were a little more candid. She might feel a little freer to vent. But the Barbara Bush of her most private diaries is exactly the Barbara Bush that stood up and talked at press conferences or addressed a literacy audience or met with friends for lunch or whatever. It was totally consistent, a totally consistent personality. And that means that she was presenting to the world exactly who she was.
Well, and I will say this. Jimmy and I were with them the day before Barr passed away. And the guys had gotten a drink, and the aide had said to Barbara and me, would you all like something? And Barr said, I think I'll have a Manhattan. And she did. She had several sips of that before she nodded off to sleep. But she was full of spunk and life until the very end. A remarkable lady.
Well, thank you all so much for sharing those memories. And We're going to hear from Laura Bush, and then we will have our panel of grandkids.
For over 50 years, it was said that the winner of Wellesley's annual hoop race would be the first to get married. Now they say the winner will be the first to become a CEO. Both of those stereotypes show too little tolerance for those who want to know where the mermaids stand. So, so I want to offer a new legend. The winner of the hoop race will be the first to realize her dream, not society's dreams, her own personal dream. Who knows? Somewhere out in this audience may even be someone who will one day follow in my footsteps and preside over the White House as the president's spouse, and I wish him well.
That was so great, Amar. Thank you to Susan Baker and to Andy Card and Susan Page and Cokie Roberts. Thank you all for that terrific discussion on Barr. I come from a family of strong women, including my mother-in-law, Barbara Bush. As that video showed, Barbara Bush led our country and the Bush family with grace and quick wit. When she died, we celebrated her beautiful life with a memorial service in Houston, and then we drove to College Station to the Bush's gravesite at the Bush Library on the Texas A&M University campus. On our drive, thousands of people lined the streets and waved flags, and those Texas men took off their cowboy hats and placed them over their hearts. When we reached the burial site at the Bush Presidential Library, we were welcomed by 700 saluting Texas A&M cadets. It was a lovely tribute to a remarkable woman. President George H.W. Bush is doing fine. He's in Maine. He misses Barr, and I'll have to say Maine is a lot quieter this summer without her. But he's in good spirits, and he'll head back to Houston in October. George and I believe that his parents have shown us the way to age with grace. In Maine, Barr walked her dogs on the beach every day, twice a day. There are two times, early in the morning and late afternoon, when dogs are allowed on the beach. So she would walk her dogs both times a day. Then a couple of summers ago, she began to walk with a walker. And then last summer, she couldn't walk on the beach, so she wildly drove her golf cart around Walker's Point with her little dogs running behind her for exercise. Barr once said, "For heaven's sake, enjoy life. Don't cry over things that were or things that aren't. Enjoy what you have now to the fullest." From George's parents, we've learned that all we know we have is now. So take advantage of your life as it is and walk on the beach every chance you get. Now we're going to get to hear from five of Barbara Bush's grandchildren, who will reflect on how their lives have been shaped by the lessons their Granny taught them. I'm happy to introduce Ellie LeBlanc Sosa. I hope Ellie's going to come out now. Is she coming? Ellie. Ellie's first. Ellie is Darrow's daughter. She works for a healthcare nonprofit, and she recently wrote a book, George and Barbara Bush, A Great American Love Story. And guess what? You can buy a signed copy outside the auditorium after the program. Pierce Bush. Pierce is Neil's son. Pierce lives in Houston, and he's the CEO of Big Brothers Big Sisters Lone Star. Jeb Bush Jr. Oh, yeah, give him an applause. Jeb Bush Jr., son of Governor Jeb Bush and Kolu, serves as managing partner of Jeb Bush and Associates, and he serves on a number of nonprofit boards, and he lives in Florida. And then we have our two daughters. Barbara Bush is the co-founder and board chairman of Global Health Corps. And Jenna Bush Hager is a correspondent with NBC's Today Show. As George says, she's just continuing the Bush family tradition of warm relations with the media. They're joined by our moderator, Cokie Roberts. Please join me in welcoming them to the stage.
So Barbara and Jenna have to share.
Yes, for Cokie. We fit, actually, which is a surprise.
Well, we shared a womb.
Yes.
So, at your grandmother's funeral, Jeb Bush, your dad, in his beautiful eulogy, did say that she struck fear in the hearts of her grandchildren, that she was a benevolent dictator, but not always so benevolent. I'm sure you all have stories that we want to hear, but I'll start with you, Barbara, because you and Jenna have written some of these stories in Sisters First, and tell us the story of being in the bowling alley at the White House when you were 7 years old.
Well, yes, so it might have been implied earlier on the earlier panel, but we all called our grandmother Ganny, or we called her the enforcer because she was the enforcer in our household. And so when my grandfather first became president, all of us went to the inauguration. We were so excited. We were about to move into the White House. We had no idea what it was going to be like, but when you were seven, it's about to be magical. And so Jenna and I went, and we had heard that there was a bowling alley. So we went in to the bowling alley. This was about the second day my grandparents had been in the White House, and we were bowling and having a blast. And there was a phone on the wall.
So?
So we picked up the phone. And we don't know what we were doing on the phone, but we picked it up and we ordered two grilled cheese sandwiches to the bowling alley.
Peanut butter and jelly.
Oh yeah, peanut butter and jelly. Two peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
We're both really jet lagged, by the way.
So. We both just landed, so our details are up. Peanut butter and jelly. So we're playing, we're so excited. Like, what is a White House peanut butter and jelly sandwich gonna taste like? And we continue bowling, and then we hear footsteps come to the door. We're getting more and more excited. And instead of our sandwiches, our grandmother walks in, and she is not happy. And she gets mad at us and tells us that this is a home. It is a borrowed home and not a hotel, and we will never order anything from the bowling alley again.
Did any of you ever order things?
No.
Only you guys. I feel like we suffered, and then it was a legend that spread throughout the
country.
Yeah, we learned from y'all.
You knew not to order. We like came up crying, hungry.
And then we never knew what it was going to taste like.
Yes.
Well. But it didn't stop when you were children, right? You also write in the book, Jenna, about a tennis game at Kennebunkport.
Yes. Well, we still got reprimanded. I will say, Barbara and I spoke to our Ganny right on the Sunday before she passed away. We live four blocks from each other in New York City, and she walked over, and we just didn't know how long we had, so we called her on speakerphone, and she said, we cried. We all cry. You'll see. I mean, if you do your job right, this is very easy.
Everyone,
I know.
Very
easy. I'm crying too.
And we both burst into tears, and I think she could tell that we were weeping, and she said, girls, don't worry. Don't worry.
She said, stop believing everything you're reading. They're making it sound like I'm gonna die any minute right now.
It was funny, but it was also, and maybe this is me reading into it as her granddaughter, her trying to comfort us.
Yeah.
Her trying to make sure that we didn't weep on the phone with her in the last conversation. You'll have time to come see me. Don't believe everything they say. Meanwhile, she's the one that said she was getting off comfort care. But yes, when I was in my 30s, I was reprimanded by my grandmother. And I had just had a baby, and we had a tennis tournament going on. in Kennebunkport, and my tennis was suffered, and I could blame it on my baby, but really, I just have never been a great tennis pro. And so we were playing, and I was actually playing with the tennis pro because I set up the tournament, and I wanted to win. And so when I wasn't hitting great strokes, or whatever you call them, I would...
it's really a sport.
Yes. Yeah. I would make some sort of gestures. Y'all were... Some of you were there.
I was there. Yeah.
I lifted my skirt. Yeah. I had shorts underneath, but I did some things. And
she did the worm.
I did the worm. That was impressive.
It was actually really good.
I had a C-section.
Yeah.
But my grandmother did not like it, but she didn't say anything. I got home. My children started preschool, so shows you the age of me. And I get a letter in the mail, and it's addressed to Jenna and George.
Right, right.
Because
so it wasn't
my dad.
It wasn't just you. It was also the former.
No,
president.
Because my dad likes the things like the worm.
Dad was like on the sideline being like, that's my girl.
He liked the behavior. So she wrote a really, she was mad. And I cried. Like Henry came home from work. He's like, what's wrong? I'm like, my grandmother is very mad. And he's like, why? I'm like, because of that tennis tournament a month ago. You know? He barely remembered it. But I called my dad like in tears.
And he had gotten the same letter?
He got in the same letter. It was just photocopied. And he just said, oh, come on, I've already thrown it away. But the PS said, don't show it to anybody. And then we
and then
published
Jenna published it in our book.
I decided I should publish it. And
that's that journalistic instinct. It's not always good.
But she didn't like it because our grandfather was raised to be a good sportsman. And I think she thought, even though I bet he probably thought it was funny. I mean, I don't know. But I think she was embarrassed because she would have thought that his mother, who was, by the way, a really good tennis player, that's the difference.
But also a little scary.
Yeah. Well, no, his mother was lovely, but she was very athletic. And so I think she wouldn't have needed to do the worm. Anyway.
So what about the rest of you? Times when your grandmother just came down on you?
Oh, Pierce.
Why me?
Pierce.
Well, yeah, so their cousins are indicating I might be the one to take this. You know, I always felt like Danny would pick on people that she felt like could take it, first of all.
Yeah.
And as was said in the original panel, she was the great defender of her family to other people in the public, but man, she would let you have it. So one time, I just graduated from college. I was kind of in a spot in life. I went to University of Texas. It happened to be TCU. I don't know, maybe some UT people here, maybe not. Okay, none.
Not one. Wow.
Well, you're one.
I am. Jeb is.
Yeah, Jeb.
Come on now.
I forgot about that. You went there.
Yes.
Come on.
So anyways, I graduated from UT. Didn't really know what I was going to do in life. And my grandmother, as all of our cousins can attest, hated idleness. And so graduating and having like 2 months of kind of unknowing was not a good period to be around her in the first place. Second of all, she had double knee surgery that summer. This was summer of 2008. Third thing to add to kind of what I'm about to build up, I had wrecked my grandfather's boat the day before.
Not good.
Which, thank you. Uncle Jordan, that was a pretty serious offense in our family. In fairness, it wasn't really my fault, but I feel my grandmother looking upon me saying, nobody likes excuses. So, happened, I was the man at the helm as it kind of was sitting on rocks. So long story short, that next day, trying to do a good deed, what I thought was a good deed, I took my cousin Robert, Ellie's brother, to a movie where a Dairy Queen, and I get a call from my dad, and he says, Pierce, where are you? Ganey has noticed the smart car is missing. She thinks you might be driving her smart car. There was a rule in our family. You could take Ganey's smart car, but you had to ask her permission. Well, she had just had double knee surgery. She was taking a nap. So long story short, I show up at the big house.
So, so your father has gotten a call from his mother saying, "Where is my car?"
Yeah, and my dad is like, my uncle knows this, and my aunt, of course. My dad is like the happiest go-lucky guy. And so he, like his voice, there's almost joy in this, like knowing what I'm about to receive. So anyways, I show up. There's this nice couple from Houston who I've never met, John and Terry Havens. I'm like, again, trying to stake out my own and figure out what I'm gonna do with my life. And she, in front of these guests who I've never met, it, like just scolds me to the point where you know, I was in tears, to be honest. I had to leave the room. I guess I was 22, so I don't know why I said 18. It's embarrassing. But, you know, look, she had a point, and I will say this.
You had wrecked the boat the day before.
Well, and that was a pretty big deal. Gamby, by the way, handles his anger in a slightly different way. There was just, like, you know, he has the kind of kindness and... You know. But Danny, but here's the truth about my grandparents. I think my cousins would agree. Every single one of my cousins is doing something in some small way that is bigger than their own kind of career, their own financial success. With there's nothing wrong with making money by any means, but my grandmother and our grandmother never let us take the fact that our grandparents were president for granted. She always instilled in us that yes, we might grow up in this unique set of circumstances, but you should use that to better the lives of others. And there's not one cousin that I can think of that...
Don't mention it if you can.
No, don't name
it.
Well, okay, none
in
here.
Yeah.
No, but there's everybody that isn't, you know, and it's like, she's like that strong, she's not Sicilian, but she's like that strong Sicilian grandmother that, you know, that all of her kids and grandkids are better because of it.
Well, you've said, actually, So, because I was trying to learn more about you boys, I knew more about the girls, which forced me to go to Twitter. Oh, Lord. Which I don't like to do because there are other people on Twitter.
Who's that?
But you did say at some point, Pierce, that she said, you can't really have a successful life unless you serve other people.
Yeah. I mean, she... You know, she embodied that, but again, it was through some of the tough love lessons that we got. And I think Andy expressed it well when he said she was the embodiment of love, but her love came in a way of knowing that you could do something great with your life. And so as it pertained to us, and I assume my uncle and others, you know, she was passionate about us not living idle lives, not taking a position for granted, and doing something that matters.
Jeb?
You know, I had to call a little streak maybe of a kind of a hellraiser at times. But I was very blessed because, you know, when they finished their serving in the White House, it was right when my parents were getting into politics in 93. So I was very, now looking back on it, extremely fortunate that I got to spend every summer up at Kenny Bunkport, really from 8 to 18. For 10 years, I would spend 3.5 months up there.
And did most of you?
He's been it by himself.
Yeah, so I got the
full. Really,
yeah, we would go in the summer, but he would go all summer.
All summer, working up there.
He would go for the entire summer.
And yeah, she would, you know, certainly chew our butt from time to time, put it politically correct. But she kept everyone in line. She kept us all in order between the 21 grandkids, all the guests. We all, you know, stood up straight, said yes, ma'am, looked people in the eye, and shook them firm hands. So that was those are lessons that she taught us.
And Ellie, you have had the great joy in the last period of your grandmother's life of writing this book about their love life. Yes, look at this wonderful.
Look, Ellie.
Do we know who the baby is who's being christened in that picture?
Well, that's Ellie. Oh, the baby being christened.
Ashley,
is that Ashley?
Maybe. I think it's Ashley.
Yeah, that's my sister, Ashley.
It's a great picture.
I didn't look happy in that picture.
But, Ellie, writing this book was must have been really special.
It was incredibly special, and I remember when I was first thinking about writing it, I knew I needed to talk to two people before we went forward, and one was my mom, and I talked to her first, and she was
supportive and excited, and then she said, but you have to talk to Gani. We both knew my grandmother had to be on board in order for this to work. So I'll never forget, I went in to talk to her. It was in Maine, and she was in her bedroom in Maine, and I walked in and I pretty much dropped a bomb on her. I said, Gani, I'm thinking of writing a book. And she was like, what, you? Out of everyone, like, what? and then I said, well, yes, and Gani, I think it's gonna be about you and Gampy and your love story. And without skipping a beat, she says, why would you wanna write a book about that? That sounds so boring. And I was like, Gani, no, but like everyone, you know, it's your love story, you know, their love story, we all know, it's so unbelievable. And she ended up being totally on board, and like Susan, I was able to interview her several times, which was really special, especially during her last year with us. I remember just about 10 days before she passed away, my mom was with her in the hospital, and we had planned to do some sort of interview with her, and I texted my mom and I said, don't worry about it, you know, she wasn't doing well, let's not do it. And my mom calls me and says, here's, Gani's on the line, she wants to do it. So I have a co-author for my book, so I immediately got my co-author on, and we're like, oh, and she's like, oh my gosh. I said, my grandmother's on the line. So we had our, the last time I talked to her was about 10 days before she passed away, and she was still as funny and sharp as ever. I said, at one point, I said, Gani, was there anything in your life that you regret? And she said, well, she's like, I would have been thinner, smarter, prettier, funnier. And then she said, no, but seriously, you're not gonna meet anyone any happier in the world. And so just to be able to hear those words from her during the last time that I talked to her was really special. So
she also seems to have inspired you all to love books. Jenna, you wrote, you know, I'm going to miss sharing books with her so mm-hmm. much.
She did, yeah. I mean, it was a little bit when we were younger, and we would go visit Maine. I think that was, by the way, the moment that Andy referenced. We lived in Midland, Texas, and our grandparents were the vice president and the vice president's wife in D.C., so we didn't get to see him as much as little toddlers, but we lived next to Jenna and Harold Welch, who were and are my mom's parents, and so we didn't really know our other grandparents as well, and I think that's the moment where they came to Midland, am I right, Mom? And my mom taught us to say Gani. But yeah, we love to read. Our whole family does. I mean, the first thing I said to my dad when we landed today was, I just finished a great mystery. And I think that she was the one that inspired that in all of us. And I think it's because she was an adventurer. And you didn't, you know, you sort of got to this. But I can't even imagine being a young mother and moving away right. from everybody that you know. I knew, but also
to a place that was barely existing.
Also away from everything I know, moving from Greenwich, Connecticut to Midland, Texas, right. which is where that picture was taken, and luckily she did that so that here we are.
We are here.
Here we are. I think doing that as a young mom, and my grandfather traveled quite a lot, and to lose a daughter, I mean, I'm in a similar state of life as she is at that moment. And I can't imagine not having a support system, even though I don't live close to my parents either. But
you live close to your sister?
I live four blocks. And I think, and they come to visit and what, you know, they're not that helpful anyway. But so I think.
That is so rude.
No, I mean, they're helpful.
That is rude.
They love them, but they don't change a diaper.
No.
They're
rusty.
It's remarkable to know what kind of a maverick, an adventurer she was. And I think that goes with reading. I think there's no better adventure than to lose yourself in a book. And she did annoy us when we were little and kept asking us mm-hmm. if we finished our summer reading every day. No. And we hadn't.
No, of course. No.
So it like hung over. Yeah, that, right. that was already... You know, the annoyance of knowing that you have work left to do.
Neil, I noticed that you were on TV recently talking about books that have, Pierce,
yes.
books that have influenced.
Looks like me.
I know, I'm sorry.
The beard.
Which my grandmother, by the way, would be very upset.
Yeah, I hear you. Gosh. What? She gave me grief about the beard.
Oh, like 3 days before she died, she was like, you have got to shave that beard. And I noticed, I was actually in Maine this weekend visiting my grandfather, and so I didn't have time to cut it, and I feel so bad about that. This is like the worst place, and it's so scraggly. Anyways,
so you were going on to talk about books that have influenced us. Did you include Pride and Prejudice?
Did I include that?
Her favorite book.
Oh, yeah. You know, we never talked about her favorite book. She really would spend time, like my cousins alluded. I mean, she would force me as a kid to read out loud to her to make sure I was doing the summer reading. And I'm sure Jenna.
Oh, yeah.
Jenna is in Maine.
She would scream. We would be up in the dormitory, and she'd be yelling from downstairs, Jenny, damn, have you done your summer reading?
So you're like, no.
No.
You know, started looking for it right away.
We're working on it.
Yes, ma'am.
The other thing that you all have talked about is her being the glue that held everybody together. And you know, it's kind of important now that the glues still stick. So what are you guys doing?
This is the question she's trying to get us, y'all. I warn you. Well, I think going to Maine was very sad because she was the, also, not only was she the glue that held us together, which I think, you know, I've wrote, but it, and I think a lot of people have said, it sounds cliche, she also had such a huge presence. Mm-hmm. And she was up early, and to wake up and not see her in the little screened-in porch where she woke up first of all was sad. Somebody else?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have up in Kennebunkport, there's a room, two couches, TV, and you know, last couple years she probably would watch a little less news, perhaps, and but it would be the meeting place every morning where, you know, 5:30, 6 a.m., she'd be in there with her robe, legs crossed, reading. She would always be writing letters, kind of checking with people, I would assume, from all over the world. And she would kind of, people would come in and out to grab a cup of coffee, and she would, you know, what's on the dance card today, Jebby, what are you going to do? Better not be sitting around, you know, not doing anything. And, but it was a very special time in the morning where we got to spend, you know, 30 minutes, an hour, just, and she would, she wouldn't hold back her opinions what was going on. So it was a special time.
And it's quieter without her. This summer, all of us went to Maine. Of course, our grandfather is still there right now. And I went the first week that he got there, and it was just us two in the house. And I said, you know, it's so quiet without Ganny. And he looked at me and he goes, are you trying to tell me that she talked too much? But it is, we miss her, it's quieter.
And I think because she included him, you know, and somebody, one of the odd things about having a public figure as somebody you love, and I wonder if y'all agree, is that I was alone. My family was here actually for an event at the Bush Library. Henry had flown. We joke that he's the Jared Kushner because he joined the board of the Bush Center. just kidding.
We were not invited to join the board.
No, we weren't invited, so he really is the Jared Kushner. We don't know who Ivanka is yet. Is it you?
I haven't been invited.
Okay, so I was alone, and it's very interesting, and it's something we're all gonna have to get used to have somebody that you love and know so well spoken about by people, some of whom, of course, know her, but some of whom are you know, political figures. Mm-hmm. And it hurt when I was alone. I was like, this person, you know, doesn't even know. And somebody said something like, the Bush insiders knew she would die first.
Oh, gosh.
And it made me mad, and I didn't have anybody to really get mad about. You know, my husband was already here. I just thought, this is, and then as the weeks go by, people will come up and say, I love your grandmother. Mm-hmm. I loved her. And so it's hard at first. And then it's this beautiful thing, because mm-hmm. I've had friends lose people that they love that, you know,
nobody
then life
knows,
continues.
Right?
And that's an interesting thing. I don't know why I just brought that up. I got lost
but
with the Jared
true.
Kushner.
Yeah. No, it's true. Just the amount of, you know, people don't, you know, necessarily talk to me all the time about my grandparents, because I'm one of the people that doesn't have the last name Bush, so I can get by without people knowing. But I just, after my grandmother passed away, it's the amount of people, and all of us had the same thing, that reached out, like, just people you haven't talked to in years and saying how my grandmother touched them in different ways. It was amazing. And
it kind of cushions you with love to have people do that. It really is special.
And we learned so much more about her that we wouldn't have known when we were younger. I work in global health now, and I received emails from people that were kids at the home when she was there that said, your grandmother, I hope you know this, I've never told you this, it's never come up in a meeting, but your grandmother taught the world that we were fighting a disease, we weren't fighting people. And, you know, that's changed history completely.
I was gonna ask you that, Barbara, because Bono said she was the godmother of PEPFAR, and your mother, of course, mother of PEPFAR. But was that part of your inspiration for starting the Global Health Corps?
Yes and no. I mean, PEPFAR certainly was, but I actually got to know a lot more about my grandmother's experience in working in AIDS well afterwards, because we were so little then. We were, you know, probably 5 years old, so the year that we were born was the year that AIDS was discovered. But I will say part of the reason that I work in global health is completely what Pierce said, just in that it never occurred to me to not work on something that I thought I could solve or try to make a tiny little dent in. And I chose a bit of a beast of global health trying to make a dent in it. But that was just how I was gonna be in the world, and that was very much shaped by her.
And I think the thing, Barbara wrote something really beautiful that's gonna be in our new paperback version of Sisters First, in case you're interested.
It'll be out later in October.
October 23rd. but she wrote something and it moved me so much. She said that Maine this summer felt a little like Ganey made us feel like we needed to be better. And that could mean tuck in our shirts or brush our hair, which there was plenty of that. I mean, you know, what is that bikini? And you don't
and
really.
And like, why did you pierce your belly button? Because you're not that skinny.
She didn't exactly say that to me. That is so rude, but she's right. Don't highlight your problem areas, you know? Why would you highlight your problem areas? She was right. And so that was intimidating as teenagers and as little children, but I think she made us better. And I think that this summer in Maine, and we have little kids, some of us, we have jobs, we're tired, but you're like, wait, what? So now who's gonna hold us up to this standard? And there wasn't anybody.
I actually hear that you actually broke rules in Kennebunkport this summer. You went the wrong way on some of the roads.
Well, I didn't do that. But we said my dad needs to learn how to be the matriarch. We were like, Dad, that is not
and
how
it's
a matriarch.
Your role now.
Grow your hair out and be a matriarch.
Ellie, you saw them going the wrong way on the roads.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
What's the right? I didn't even know we had a rule.
The fork in the road?
Yeah.
They go right.
You have to always go right.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, Barbara hasn't driven a car since 1971. So.
I mean, it's been a while, but I didn't know.
Okay. Oh. Now you do. So it was you that broke it.
Yeah, unknowingly.
Well, how about the Taco Day story?
Don't say it.
So kind of a cute story regarding my grandparents and just their relationship, but as long as I can remember, I mean, literally we had Taco Sunday every Sunday. 1 o'clock, the whole family would get together in the big house. We would have tacos. You know, I personally liked it. It was pretty good. And, you know, I guess my grandmother led the charge. Said every Sunday we're doing it. We're inviting friends after church. We're going to do our Sunday, Taco Sunday. And I guess this year someone asked Gampy, so are we going to be doing our Taco Sunday? He said, well, I don't really like tacos. So, you know, the poor guy has been holding it in for...
It's Burger and Dog Day now.
Burger and Dog Day, and I'm so
sad. So now we still
sad.
Have Taco Day, but we have hamburgers and hot dogs.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But he... So
that's the one I'm still...
And I think he, you know, and Ellie can talk about it, he loved her just as much. That he would, you know, that it took till she passed away...
To stop having
to say, I'd rather have a hamburger and a hot dog.
Suffered years of tacos. And never knew he didn't like them.
And loved her so much that he'd have a dog in bed with him who bit him.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
That dog, may he rest in peace.
They're still alive.
Oh, they're alive still?
They're still alive.
They're still alive. They live in Texas. Oh.
But that dog bit almost everybody's bottoms.
He hung on to Barbara's.
He attacked.
But he also bit your grandfather.
He bit our grandfather in the middle of the night when they...
He bit Dad this year.
Yeah.
And what Ganny would say would be like, you provoked him. Like, even to her firstborn.
But Ellie, when you were doing the book, did she actually talk about the love story?
She did. It was hard to get her to talk
about
it
at
first because she doesn't like talking about herself. But I managed to get it out of her. There were, I think, a big part of their love story that we found through all the, just through my experience watching them too, is humor has always been a huge, huge part of it. I'm saying this because I want to tell a story about, and this might be inappropriate, but I think I'm going to try it and see what happens.
We got us here. It's not inappropriate.
Yeah. Okay, we're good.
Henry Jared.
Okay, we're good. All right. So you guys know the story. So a few years ago, my mom got a gift for her birthday, and it was a fart machine.
It was a what?
Okay,
that's
okay. What? Yeah.
What was it?
Oh, a fart machine. Okay, is this okay?
All right. Yeah,
fine.
She's
it's
okay.
Fine. Okay, I don't know. So anyway, so it's a little machine. You hide it under someone's chair, and then someone else has a remote control, presses it. So my mom, when she got it, the first thing she thought was, she said, Gampy will love this, my grandfather. And so she said, let's bring it over to dinner. So we brought it over to dinner, and we gave it to Gampy, and this was just 2 years ago. So he loved it. He thought it was so funny. He was pressing it over and over. And there was a big table of us, like cousins, sitting at the dinner table, and we're all laughing hysterically. We thought it was so funny because we're all really immature. And then dinner goes on. It's away, and we all forget about it. Dinner goes on, and we have dinner. We have dessert because we have dessert for every meal. And then at the end of dinner, Ganny announces, I'm going to bed. So good night, everyone. And she gets up. She has her walker. She's walking down the table, down by everyone. Good night, good night, good night. And just as she gets to Gampy, he presses, like under his bottom or something, he presses it, and it goes off. And it was just like, the timing was perfect. We had forgotten all about it. And she rolls her eyes, hits him, and she's like, grow up, George. And she walks away. That was just like the classic example of their relationship.
She wasn't very happy.
Yeah, she was not. She did not think it was funny, but we all thought it was hilarious.
She did love to laugh. Like, I'm surprised. She just didn't. I think when everybody was laughing at something that immature, she was like,
yes.
Come on.
You can get that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You also tell a wonderful story, though, Ellie, about going to the library and going through her scrapbooks. Mm-hmm.
So we all know that our grandmother loved taking pictures, and we saw that scrapbook she would keep of pictures of all of us in the more recent years. I didn't realize how much she kept from her entire life until I was starting research for my book, and I was able to go down to College Station to my grandfather's library, and they have the archives there. And my co-author and I were like, okay, we're here for a day and a half, let's go, let's do it. So 8 a.m., first day we walk in, and Mary Finch, who works at the library there, was like, okay, where do you want to start? And she opens the door, and it is like millions and millions of different like scrapbooks and books and tapes and videos and things. And we're like, what? We have no, oh my God, we only have a day and a half. Anyway, we started in her scrapbooks. So my grandmother had kept scrapbooks from every part of their life together. And we started in the Yale scrapbook when they were at Yale. They were a young married couple, and they had George W. And we were going through and looking at all the pictures. My grandmother had written all her notes by every single one. And we get to an envelope, and it was like protruding. You could see something coming out of it. And I said, can we see what's inside there? And she's like, yeah, I don't even know what's in there. So she pulls it out, and out of the envelope comes a wishbone. And we're like, what is this? And we looked down, and my grandmother in her writing had said, wishbone from our first Thanksgiving turkey together.
Aww.
And so it was at that point that we were like, okay, we're going to be good, because we've got their first Thanksgiving wishbone together. But it was just amazing the foresight she had. Well, I mean, she was keeping all these things just for our family to have. This was before they were in any sort of, you know, public service roles. So it was really special to be able to have access to all of those things in the book.
And carrying it on?
Well, I want to ask how to be a matriarch. I want to ask you how many kids you have to be a matriarch, what turns you into a matriarch, how my dad should behave as the next matriarch. But anybody, can anybody answer that?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's reading to our kids. I have two daughters, one 7 and 4, and you know, we used to come up there during the summers, and I think really reading to our kids is something that she told me to do, but I'm sure we're going to keep doing it.
But also, she was so proud of her great-grandchildren. She was so proud. I had a little baby in Georgia, must have been, well, just 2 years older than Mila, my oldest, and she would say, now, Georgia is so smart. Georgia can read. And, you know, Mila was like, bopping around, and I'm like, oh, gosh. And she's like, there's this app that Georgia has. and she was so proud of them, and I think, and then became prouder, too, of
right,
mine.
Right, once
as
they
well.
Could read.
Well, they can't read that, but just prouder of, you know, whatever it is in them that I think she loved. And that is a legacy. I mean, I think, and the thing is, they'll remember her. Mm-hmm. My, right. At least my oldest will, and she still... says prayers, and I think she does it because I cry and she knows that it's sweet. She likes attention. I'm not sure where she got that. But she'll say right after, she said, you know, dear God, Ganny's up there now. You know, look out for Ganny. And she said, don't worry, Mama, we're not going to forget her because I'm going to draw you a ton of pictures. And that's her legacy. And how amazing that our girls will get to remember what a badass woman. Definitely. Oh, you can say your name.
Are you all having your a name? Private conversation?
They shouldn't have put us on the same chair.
You know, we're like having our own panel down here.
I one of the sweetest texts I got, and I thought about this, although I didn't expect it in that way, I guess, was after she passed from an employee who works at Big Brothers Big Sisters with me, who said, live her legacy. And there were so many nice texts, but something about that really grabbed at my heartstrings and pulled out the emotions for me. And I think it is because when you think about her legacy, it is that speech at Wellesley. It is that picture with that baby. It is sticking up for underdogs. And I think about that and all the ways... that she's done that for me. And then I think about it, you know, I just got married in March, right before she passed away. And first of all, she...
We saw the pictures of your uncle dancing at your wedding.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That was leaked.
That was leaked. So, yeah, he's a good dancer. So I married this amazing young woman who my grandmother loved. And to the point, she was like, Pierce, don't mess this up. And she loved my stepsister's boyfriend, too. So she had a plot to marry them if we messed it up with each other, which was kind of weird. Yeah, it was a little weird. But you know, it's exactly right. And my wife, you know, comes from a somewhat difficult past. And she shared that with my grandmother. My grandmother loved that about her, just how she'd overcome that as a child, she loved the underdog.
I think a legacy of hers that I've thought a lot about since she died is fierceness and fearlessness. I mean, she knew, she walked into death, and we're all human beings are scared of dying, and she knew she was gonna die, and she chose how to die, and she chose how to do it gracefully. And she was fearless. If she loved you, she was fearless speaking about anything that she cared for. And that's not necessarily what you think of when you think of an older white-haired woman wearing pearls, but she was fearless. And the day that she died, I woke up in the middle of the night, and I have had a complicated relationship with my own name just because I've had a number of various experiences.
You should say.
I'll say one. Well, I've had many where I've gone to go speak at conferences and everyone's so excited and I'll lurk around thinking, you know, certainly they're gonna notice that the speaker's here. And they think my grandmother is going to arrive. But we have one classic family tale where my cousin Wendy, for some reason, was gonna email me.
No, not for some reason.
Well, I don't know the...
Okay, go ahead.
You're implying something.
Okay, sorry.
My cousin Wendy sent me an email, and the subject was waxing, laser hair removal, or electrolysis. And she writes the email, and she says, yo, what up? I'm thinking about getting laser hair removal. I'm considering electrolysis. Do you wax your bikini line? What do you do? And she sends the email, except it auto-filled my grandmother's email address. And 5 seconds later, without missing a beat, my grandmother replies and said, hi, Wendy, I actually don't do any of the above. I just shave. I recommend staying far, far away from harsh products like Nair. Oh my God. And I can't wait to see you this summer. And so I've had, you know, weekly experiences sharing the same name as my grandmother. And I just, the night that after she died, I woke up and I just, even though I've had a complicated relationship with it, I just thought, now that's so lucky because it's a reminder to be fearless like her every single day, that it's not something to be worried if someone knows my name. I should just be fearless and live the way that she did. And that's something that I get to have forever, and I'm so grateful.
Right, and to rejoice in it.
Yeah.
Well, the whole country got to know.
I thought
there's some Kleenex here. There is.
She did. No, actually, it didn't work. I'm sorry. She's not crying.
I know you didn't bring us all the tears, but I think we're all dehydrated from flying today.
Yeah, we're dehydrated.
You're all tearing up. It's
yes. I was tearing up. Just kidding. We were. We loved her.
Very, very much. We miss her all the time.
Yes.
We all loved her. The whole country came to love her. And you all are in the position of having the very special relationship that you, I know, because she'll be watching you, will carry on. So thank you all very, very
thank
much.
You so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all. This family is a national treasure, and it was a joy to be in the audience and hear the stories of the matriarch of this great, wonderful family that we are all blessed to have here in Dallas. Thank you, Cokie, for moderating, and thank you, Highland Capital, for sponsoring, and all of you for being here and participating and being such great supporters of the Bush Center. The rest of our fall lineup is also very exciting in October. We have on the 22nd the Highland Capital Lecture on artificial intelligence and the disruptive technologies of our lives. And Admiral McRaven will be here on November 13th. The First Lady's exhibit will be up till October 1st if you haven't seen it already. And of course, members get first dibs on all of our events. So please, if you're not already, please join. Thank you all for being here. And again, thank you for a wonderful, wonderful evening.